there, and what do you do about all those Bangladesh?
From my experience in the Niger Delta, I know there is a policy that Shell operates within communities. What they do when they get into communities like that, they look for some criminal elements who they think they can leave the security of their pipelines. And then they pay them a certain amount of money to protect their pipelines. And at the end of the day, there's division within this sort of criminal element. Another section is saying, well, we didn't get the contract, so we're going to prove to Shell that the person they gave that kind of contract to is not capable of securing their pipelines. So there's this sabotage occurring as a result of even Shell the internal working policy within communities. And also, we've heard many times, and even in our meeting with Sumono in December in Lagos, he admitted that when Shell is taking money for whatever social project into communities, they give it to the leaders of the communities, like the chiefs, and most of the time it is obvious that these people are corrupt. So they still go ahead to give these people money, and then the money does not come down to the people within the community. And so there is this tension rising from the people and their leadership. And as they begin to fight among themselves, Shell is drilling oil.
How do you assess the security level in the Niger Delta? Is it safe for employees of Shell and other companies to do the necessary cleanup?
Talking about pipes not being safe for them to get access to, I can take you back to an attack by the militant group some time ago, I think 2008, I can't remember precisely, on one of the biggest Shell deep offshore platform, which is the Bonga oil field. And it took Shell just 10 days to restore that platform to normal working conditions. So I think the first thing I think Shell consider when such reports come to them is the commercial viability of such a pipe that has been vandalized or sabotaged. And then when it is considered not to be of much commercial benefits, and it's left like that, and the excuse of, you know, the place is not safe. Because we understand that Shell has direct access to the military task force that secures the area. So whenever they need to go into any place, they don't have security problems. They go there with the security of these people, if they truly want to go there. And when these people are around them, no community person dare come out because they can shoot. And there are many cases of them killing even innocent people doing common protests when they are called upon by Shell. So the excuse of the sites and locations not being safe is completely out of it, and it should not be taken seriously at all.
If Shell is true to its word, wanting to support the Nigerian government in taking care of business, my opinion at least is it should pay up. So I specifically invite you to answer that.
To the expectation of the people in regards to many court rulings, and particularly with the court ruling that you just talked about the Ebubu spills, I mean, first of all, we should consider the human impact that spill has caused to the people. This spill occurred in the Niger Delta in the 70s, during the Civil War. Now, since the 70s, it is now that Shell has taken the responsibility to even want to do cleanup. So, I mean, we should not talk about the consequence that this has had on the people, on the life of the people. Tension is rising. Ignorance is paving way for awareness. People are beginning to get aware. Now the youths are taking to arms. The parents can no longer control them because of the practices of this oil company. So they should come out straight and be transparent and carry a human face when they carry out their oil operations within the Niger Delta.
My question to Ms. Ofehe is, how important is it for example, the European Union to consider a strict visa ban for corrupt Nigerian politicians? Thank you.
I am a proponent of a strict visa ban, a European Union visa ban on corrupt Nigerian government officials. And not just corrupt Nigerian government officials, but also proving cases of politicians who indulge in massive scale oil bunkering in the Niger Delta. So it takes expertise, it takes technical know-how for you to carry out bunkering. And the massive bunkering that is taking place in Nigeria is taking place within the government, and Shell knows it, but they have refused to come out and speak about it. I'll tell you, when the crude oil comes to the manifold, between the manifold and the batches that take them to the mother vessel, there is no calculation of how many barrels of crude oil leaves the shores of Nigeria on the export market. And so I want Shell to come out openly and declare what happens between that manifold position and the final Nigeria. Most of the time, this is where even people within the Nigerian government and the politicians make their money from stealing officially crude oil. Now, the United States, during the administration of George W. Bush, had what they call the U.S. Proclamation 7750 Act, which gives the United States President and the government the power to impose visa ban on government officials and their family, or proving cases of government officials and their family who distort democracy, who are corrupt, and the effect is showing positive signs within the Nigerian government, and it's bringing some level of sanity. Because most of them, when they take their stolen loot, this is where they come out and hide this loot. If you can push the European Union, not the powers will not rest within the Dutch government alone, but if you can push the European Union to enforce this law, it will make most of the politicians whom you don't know and you cannot see to begin to sit up.
For Mr. In 2006, so 5 years ago, Shell introduced a new way of working with communities and the Global Memorandum of Understanding. And do you think that Shell's performance in the Niger Delta with your communities has improved since this agreement? And can you give some examples?
The General Memorandum of Understanding. Now, within the communities. One thing I want to state for the record here is that in as much as I stand here to criticize the role of Shell in the Niger Delta, I also want to state that I have a conscience. So when I see what is right, I will still stand to say this is right. Yes, I have carefully spoken to people about this GMOU, and it's a very good project, and it has worked in some communities. But I want to state for the record that I've tried to let Shell come out openly and show some of the good things that they are doing in the Niger Delta, so we can verify them. And if we know that those things are impacting the lives of the people positively, then we can know how to send the message across and encourage them to do more within communities. Just recently in December, I accompanied one of the members of the MP to Nigeria. And they said there was going to be a helicopter ride to one of their projects, which is the Gbaram Ubia project, which according to Shell Advatoria, it's a wonderful project. It has created job opportunity for people. It has the capacity to support power projects in the Niger Delta. But unfortunately, one of the staff from BA called while we were in the vehicle and said I must be dropped from that stop. So the reason why I was dropped, I still don't know. But if actually this project is as positive as they claim it is, I don't know why they wouldn't want somebody like me to see it.
Mr. Ofeye, you talked about pressure on the shoulders of Nigerian people. And on the shoulders of the Dutch parliament. But you also talked about hope, because there's also pressure on Shell now, and that's the momentum you were talking about. My question is, what is the first thing that the Dutch government should do to make Shell operations socially acceptable?
I stand here to say that the people of Niger Delta don't hate Shell. They hate the practice of Shell. Shell has created employment, yes. Shell has given opportunity to some local people in terms of contract, yes. Shell has provided scholarship to people, yes. We want Shell to be concerned about how they deal with the environment of the people in the course of making their profit. If they can do this, perhaps someday we will return back to the same way it was before, when Shell staff, who are Dutch, used to rent our compounds, our properties in the city, and live with us in unity and in peace. It is only when they come out and carry out best practices that meet international standards, that this unity can bring the hope that we all think we truly deserve. Thank you.